Welcome to the Trad Dads Podcast, where we examine cultural and political issues through the lens of traditional thought.
All right, so tonight I wanted to talk about the concept of bootstraps. You know, pick yourself up by your bootstraps in the context of a very specific recent event, which is California deciding to essentially regulate the gig economy out of existence in their state. And what's so interesting about this, I think, is that I've read two very different takes on this particular issue, and I think both of them are obviously wrong, obviously incorrect. And I think there's an obvious third position in here that someone could very easily take, and that if they're thinking in the right terms, they would be able to come to this conclusion fairly easily. So just to give a little bit of news about what's going on, essentially what happened was the left in California was complaining that there are a lot of jobs that are not paid some kind of benefits or something like that. They don't enjoy kind of a full-time employment scenario that a lot of people in other parts of the country do. So the target was on specific types of jobs or specific industries. One of the articles that I'll put up is specifically about the news media and the opinion, really not really news necessarily, but the sort of opinion news world. And a lot of these people that work in this area are freelancers, and they just submit their work and they get paid if the editor accepts it. And they don't work for any single publication. You know, they may write for several different publications and all this sort of thing. Another good example is Uber. Your contract with Uber, as a driver, you're just a contractor. You're not an employee. And you just get a cut of the total fare for each of the rides that you offer, and that's just the way it works. The app just facilitates your business. What I think is interesting about this is you get two very, very different takes. And so the first one I'll just talk about the left more, because they were the ones that really instigated this from a political standpoint. So the instigation came in the form of, we demand to have, benefits and to be employees and all of this kind of thing. They want these jobs normalized, right? They want to have the benefits of a full-time employed person. And so then when the legislature goes and implements this, of course, the response of the businesses is to just simply say, okay, well, we're just not going to have, freelance writers anymore. We're going to hire a very small number of people, and they're going to crank out all of our content. So these jobs are just gone. Or if they're not completely gone, they have to be paid a very tiny amount. And, there was some kind of restriction on, these freelance people were able to write, a handful of articles and stuff like that. I mean, obviously they can't bar you from, writing a letter to the editor or something. As far as your ability to make this into some kind of a stable remunerative type of profession, or even have as a relatively profitable side gig, these regulations were going to make that basically impossible, just because of the way, to an extent, you could frame it as the way the businesses responded. Well, this is not how they should have responded. They should have, just done what the lefties were clamoring for, which was, expect the same work out of them and give them all the benefits too. I think that first the analysis of this is kind of interesting, because what you kind of get is this realization that they fundamentally do not understand the reality of business in the U.S. today. They don't understand how the stuff works. They don't understand how their bosses, the people who control things, don't understand how they see things. They don't understand the concept of unintended consequences of regulation. and stuff like this. Just very fundamental, basic stuff that's very important. And again, this is not to excuse the, you know, employing people and not paying them, you know, a just wage. I'm not excusing that at all. I'm going to get to that later, actually. But I think the critique of the lefties here from, a distributist perspective or a traditionalist economic perspective would be just simply to say that, like, look, you're not you're putting a Band-Aid on a bullet wound, right? The core problem here is so much worse than what your feeble attempt at regulation is going to fix that it ends up just kind of backfiring on you, right? It's almost like you put a Band-Aid on a bullet wound and you find out the Band-Aid's dirty or something like that, right? And so it's just simply not the right medicine, and it's not going to help you. You can't just, in this climate, the way things are done now, you can't just force these benefits with regulations. There has to be another way to go, and I'm going to talk about that later. So to kind of move to the bootstrapper kind of regulation, you know, the sort of boomercon kind of thing, I'll put up a link with a timestamp for the Dan Bongino show, and Dan Bongino is he's one of these Trump or bust kind of, you know, Sean Hannity Republican types. Very generally, I listen to his show quite a bit. But on the economic stuff, I think he's just out to lunch crazy. So his response to this is to simply laugh at these people, which is not the way to do it. I mean, this is not a funny thing, right? That people aren't being paid, you know, a just wage. Now, obviously, again, my critique of the left is still there. I'm not saying they're going about it right either, but, this isn't something to laugh about, right? But his whole thing is like, well, if you don't want a job that doesn't give you full benefits, just go find another job, which is totally ridiculous. I mean, you know, these jobs are being offered and people are taking them because that's the position they're in. That does not justify the conditions that they're working under, right? Just because they agreed to them does not make them right. This is, again, one of the fundamental things that, you know, we in the sort of traditionalist side of things constantly have to battle with the boomer cons or whatever you want to call them, right? We're constantly having to do battle with these people on these ideas because they fundamentally just, they really just think that anything agreed upon is correct, is okay. They are moral relativists as much as the left-wingers are. They're just a different flavor of moral relativists. And of course, they don't want to hear that. And, you know, we could have a debate about that issue if we needed to. But what I think is interesting here is that, you know, it's sort of like if his daughter was in this position, or if his kid was in this position where, they had really crummy working conditions, right? Obviously, as a parent, you know, he would do something about this, right? He would call up on the phone and get his connections involved, right? And of course, those connections have absolutely nothing to do with, you know, his kid's ability to, you know, crank out widgets in a factory, right? It has nothing to do with his kid's, you know, marginal value product of labor, right? It's connections, right? These are the things in civil society that we use to try to influence, the financial conditions of the people we care about, right? And so if I were someone living in California, in San Francisco, and I cared about my fellow San Franciscans who were, working these types of jobs, I would do what I could to try to help them, to try to find something else for them, right? And this is perfectly legitimate behavior, but it's completely outside of a market mechanism, right? It's completely relational, and the mechanism, the way it works has nothing to do with markets. It has nothing to do with them. It has everything to do with people and how we relate and how we help each other, And so both of these cases, you have people who are just fundamentally not understanding how this ought to work and how people should be remunerated and how people should be allowed to work, the conditions under which they should be allowed or the conditions that employers should be allowed to offer to them. And so when it comes to, you know, offering an alternative, I always want to try to offer an alternative because I don't want to just be complaining. You know, you have to beat a model with a better model, right? And so to me, the better model, and, you know, I kind of lean back on a previous episode where, you know, we talked about, you know, if there was an employer who wanted to do this stuff right, if there was an employer who wanted to pay based on the needs of their employees, you know, certainly very straightforward ways to calculate this stuff with just basic tax information, right? You just look at the number of, you know, withholdings that somebody has and the number of dependents somebody has, you know, and leave it to the IRS to vet the thing. But, you know, just count their dependents and, you know, give them some kind of a pay scale based on their dependents. That's totally fine. That makes total sense. Again, part of the purpose of work and, you know, the economy, right, a large part of it is to take care of people, right? It's not to just make more efficient widgets and, you know, cheaper blenders from China. The point is for people to be provided for when they need it and, you know, in a reasonable fashion. Now, of course, that leaves all kinds of room for judgment, sure. But you can't just throw your hands up and say, well, if the regulation doesn't work, then nothing will. Or, you know, just pull yourself up by your bootstraps, Johnny. You know, it's your fault for taking this job. You know, both of these things are silly, right? People are doing things because of the positions they're put in. Now, of course, we can have all kinds of discussion about, you know, the fact that people need to put their priorities in the right order. And so when they are looking for jobs, of course they need to have the right priorities. Of course they need to have their life, you know, kind of sorted out to some extent, right? But the way they're going to do that is not through someone, you know, simply shouting, pull yourself up by your bootstraps, right? That's not effective. That's not going to change the situation. And if you care about these people, you know, if you see them as your, you know, your neighbors or your, you know, your community members or your family or your co-religionists, right, you're going to help them in some way. And that help is almost certainly not going to come through some kind of market means. So we have to think about priorities. We have to think about you know, wealth, intergeneral wealth transfers, right? Transfers. You know, I saw a statistic recently claiming that you know, millennials or you know, a certain age range right now. I don't know, 25 to 35 or something like that. And when the baby boomers were in that age range, they held 21%. Of the wealth in the U.S. Gen Xers, when they were in that age range, they held 4% of the wealth. And millennials, currently in that age range, they hold 3% of the wealth. And I think the argument you can take from this is just simply that, you know, it's very hard to have your priorities in the right order when you're just trying to scrape by paycheck to paycheck, right? And it's not to say that there aren't any boomers trying to do that. Of course there are. But what we can see is that this intergenerational wealth transfer is not happening. And so the bootstrap argument doesn't work. The bootstrap argument worked when, you know, it was an obvious sign that, you know, Johnny just was being a lazy good for nothing, when he couldn't work his way through college or, you know, when he was 22 years old and wasn't, you know, married with a good full-time job, right? Well, you know, the conditions were different in 1970. You know, things were just different then than they are now. And so we have to recognize that. And so that's where I think we go to, you know, the lefties to an extent, and we say, look, guys, you know, I appreciate your zeal, but you're tilting at windmills here with these sort of silly Band-Aid regulations, right? The bottom line is we have to figure out how we're going to shift, you know, demand and supply curves here. We have to think about how we're going to, you know, increase competition for labor, right? We have to think about how we're going to incentivize, managers and business owners to pay in a reasonably remunerative fashion that supports families, that supports supports people for their actual needs. And to some extent, maybe that is going to entail, the sort of gig economy thing just going by the wayside in a lot of industries. And I personally don't see anything wrong with that. I think this whole gig economy thing is a little, is a little silly. It's a little bit of like a facetious, entrepreneurialism, right? Being an entrepreneur is a different type of thing than, buying a car and being an Uber driver, or sitting in a coffee shop writing articles, right? I don't think that's not, to me, that's not entrepreneurial behavior, right? When it's really just in service of sort of a large corporation that's really taking a very large percentage of the profits, that's not entrepreneurialism, and so it doesn't fit that mold in my mind. So we have to talk about, potentially, some of these gig things are just, this is just not the way things are supposed to work, right? And so to that extent, I think maybe the outcome of this regulation is okay, in the longer term. And sure, it comes with some short-term pain, and that's obviously not good. But I think there needs to be, we need to be a little more creative about, how we advocate for designing incentives in this space, right? Maybe we give businesses a tax break if, they do pay on a family-based pay scale. Maybe it's more of a sort of a carrot incentive rather than a stick, right? But maybe there's room for stick incentives as well, right? I mean, maybe there is room for negative incentives for employers who are not, sort of providing this kind of family-based wage. So I think, and again, this is fundamentally different from just saying, all the employers have to pay all the benefits, right? I don't think that that deals with the problem specifically enough. I think you're trying to just put something out there that's just going to fix all the problems, and it's not, because it's not understanding what the underlying issue really is. It's just looking at a symptom of that problem and saying, well, we can treat this one symptom, and so that's going to solve the problem. It's not going to solve the problem. You're not diagnosing the issue, and you're not giving the patient the medicine that they need. You're just putting a Band-Aid on a bullet wound from an economic perspective.
As you know, we could use more voices on the traditionalist right. And one of the best ways to do that is with a podcast. I've been using Anchor.fm for this podcast and for another podcast for over a year, and I've really enjoyed it. It's free, and it allows me to upload clips and also to record and edit. It also disperses all of my podcasts to all the major platforms, including Apple Podcasts and Spotify. It also allows me to monetize and to collect donations. It's everything you need to make a podcast in one place. If you want to join me in being a voice for the traditionalist right, download the free Anchor app or go to anchor.fm to get started. Thanks for listening to the Trad Dads podcast. If you enjoyed our show, please subscribe on your favorite podcast app and consider giving us a 5-star rating on iTunes. It really helps us out.